Good evening. My name is Dr. Nina Ahmad, and I will be your moderator for this series on COVID-19 by the American Academy of Family Physicians. We will be hosting this series on Friday nights at 7 p.m. Central Standard Time. Each week, we will have a brief status update and a guest speaker. You can ask our speakers questions before and after each session through the COVID-19 Member Exchange message board. You can also ask questions through the chat feature. Speakers will try their best to answer as many questions as they can. These sessions will be recorded live, so you can always refer back to them. And the sessions are being put together based on your feedback, so feel free to comment, and we'll adjust sessions as appropriate. This session is approved for 1 AFP prescribed credits. It's an enduring credit, so you can always refer back to it. And it's also approved for 2 T2P or translation to practice credits. The speakers today have nothing to disclose. And here are today's learning objectives. For today, we'll do a quick situation summary and brief background, and then our guest speaker, Dr. Everett Schlam, the Assistant Director at Mountside Family Practice, will be speaking, and then we'll have a question and answer session and T2P reflection. So here you can see a graph that's a projection of the total number of confirmed cases of COVID-19 in the different countries. It's a snapshot. You can see the United States in red, Italy in blue, and China in green. Here you can see the distribution of reported cases in the United States as of yesterday, May 7th, 2020. And you can see the total number of cases was over 1.2 million and total deaths, 73,297. Approximately 2 out of 3 Americans will need assistance with activities of daily living or ADLs. Long-term care is a variety of services that support and meet health and personal care needs over an extended period of time. Most people actually end up having care provided for them at home, and many programs and services that help people have the care at home and through communities is through the Older Americans Act, or OAA. OAA helps provide those services. Long-term care facilities include assisted living, nursing homes, and skilled nursing facilities, or SNFs. Approximately 1 million people reside in an assisted living facility, and residents usually live in their own home or apartments or rooms and share common areas. For nursing homes and skilled nursing facilities, or SNFs, it's estimated that over 4 million Americans actually are admitted or reside into these facilities per year. Continuing care retirement communities, many of them actually offer independent living, assisted living, nursing homes, and skilled nursing facilities. These healthcare services, offer healthcare services and recreation programs as part of their services. And where someone lives is dependent on what services they would need. For long-term care facilities, the data is somewhat limited on the estimations of infections in these facilities. It's estimated about 1 to 3 million serious infections occur in a long-term care facility, and infections usually involve urinary tract infections, diarrheal diseases, antibiotic-resistant staph infections, and many others, and this is before COVID-19. Infections are a major cause of hospitalizations and death. As many as 380,000 people die of infections in a long-term care facility each year. We've heard in the news and also in some of the articles that we've gone over and some of the reports that have been coming out, what's been happening with COVID-19 in the long-term care facilities. Briefly discussed in our last session with Dr. Dux, he talked about the Northwell Healthcare System publishing an article on 5,700 patients and the outcomes of these individuals. The outcome data that was available with an endpoint of being discharged or passing away, there were 2,634 patients that were looked at, and they found 373 of them went to the ICU, 553 passed away, 320 needed an invasive mechanical ventilation, and 81 needed kidney replacement therapy. Of the 18 to 65-year-olds that needed ventilation, there was a 76% mortality rate calculated. And of those who were over 65, the mortality rate was estimated at 97.2% if they needed a ventilator. And that wasn't talking about morbidity. We know the morbidity is high in this population as well. 80% of Americans actually prefer to die at home if possible. And we know that 60% die in an acute care hospital, 20% in a nursing home, and 20% at home. So what's actually causing this gap between a patient's wishes and what's actually happening in society? Well, we know documenting and having conversations about priorities is our best mechanism for aligning what somebody's treatment is with what they actually want. And planning as soon as possible before someone is having incapacity or can't talk for themselves is always important. We know it's very difficult to have these conversations with family members of these patients who are in the middle of an emergency when or the patient's in the ICU and the patient's trying to understand or the family member's trying to understand the medical issues that are going on and having to make these decisions. So it's always better before the patient is incapacitated. According to one article that was published, most older adults at risk for morbidity and mortality due to COVID-19 have not planned adequately before admission to an ICU. It's actually estimated 1 in 3 adults have completed any type of advanced directive on end-of-life care in the United States. In 2014, a systematic review that included over 100 papers, mostly observational studies, looked at advanced care planning and what resulted. They found that when advanced care planning was done, there was increased compliance with the patient's preferences, increased quality of life for the patient and family, a decrease in subsequent hospitalization, and a decrease in hospital deaths and ICU deaths, and an increase in in-home deaths. In another article, it actually talked about barriers to following a patient's wishes and why it might be difficult to do advanced care planning. So they talked about, prior to admission, some of the issues that occur, one being complex legal language. It's difficult to understand and fill out for some people. The state-to-state variation in legal requirements, needing a witness in one state versus a notary in another state. And the current environment of physical distancing or social distancing has made it even more difficult to get notaries or witnesses. It's an uncomfortable discussion for many people. And also they noted that the feeling that ACP or advanced care planning is someone else's job, and so it never gets done. They talk about, during admissions, the visitor restrictions being implemented to decrease infections in the hospital are actually reduce the spread of COVID-19. It's actually making it more difficult to find the surrogate or talk to someone during an emergency in the ICU to find out what the wishes are for the patient. So they go on further to make proposals of what we could potentially do to help regarding the ACP issue. And they talk about saying that all clinicians and allied health professionals should engage patients in ACP, regardless of their specialty or role. They also recommend following a 3-step approach, selecting a surrogate decision maker at minimum, and encouraging that the patient actually talks to their surrogate and records wishes in an advance directive and documenting wishes in the medical record. They also recommend in their proposals health systems leveraging messaging capabilities to supply ACP information to patients, and hospitals and states temporarily pausing legal requirements for advance directives due to physical distancing and allowing clinicians to complete a physician's order for life-sustaining treatment or pulsed during phone or telemedicine video visits. With that, I'm going to introduce Dr. Everett Schlam. He's assistant director at Mountainside Family Practice and has many years of experience, over 30 years, in the full gamut of family medicine, and I'm happy he's here today.
Thank you, Dr. Ahmad, for that excellent review, highlighting the importance of advanced care planning. The SARS-CoV-2 pandemic has been particularly hitting nursing homes hard. Next slide, please. Tom Fried, the former CDC director, said it well when he said nursing homes are the ground zero for the COVID-19 pandemic. The first nursing home that was hit hard was early in 2020, when in Life Care Center in Kirkland, Washington, they had 120 residents and 180 staff. By mid-March, they had reported 30 residents had died secondary to COVID-19. And this was the first among many nursing homes to experience an outbreak of COVID-19. Outbreaks of infectious diseases in nursing homes is not new. Nursing homes are susceptible to outbreaks such as scabies, norovirus, and influenza. But the lethality of COVID-19 pandemic emphasizes the need for improved infection control for this vulnerable population. Next, please. More than 10 people in long-term facilities have died due to COVID-19, and that's probably an underestimate because up until recently, reporting wasn't mandated for nursing homes. And the states that were hit the hardest were the ones with the most COVID-19 cases, particularly New York, New Jersey, Massachusetts, and Pennsylvania. Next slide, please. So the Centers for Medicare and Medicaid Services, on April 19th, they made it mandatory that all COVID-19 cases be reported to the CDC directly. Next slide, please. So how can we prevent COVID-19 outbreaks in nursing homes? Close personal attention to all staff and residents regarding hand washing and use of personal protective equipment like N95 masks, gowns, gloves, and face shields. All employees should stay home if they feel sick, even mildly sick. Cohorting suspected infected patients to a separate area in the nursing home. Restricting all visitors to the nursing home facilities and increased availability of testing for staff and residents in a timely fashion. Next slide, please. The CDC has an excellent checklist for nursing homes and long-term care facilities that can be found on their website. Next, please. So physicians are always managing uncertainty and trying to deal with probability. So I'm gonna ask you to pay attention for a few minutes. We're gonna do a little quiz. Pick any number between 2 and 10. Next, please. Multiply that number times 9. Add the two digits of that number together. Subtract 5 from that number. Pick the letter which corresponds to that number in the alphabet. A equals 1, B equals 2, C equals 3, D equals 4. Pick a country which begins with that letter. Now take the second letter of that country and choose a large animal which begins with that letter. Next slide, please. This study was published in the New England Journal of Medicine, April 24th, 2020. A nursing facility also in Washington, very close to the first outbreak in a nursing home, did control measures on February 29th, 2020. Residents were assessed twice daily for fever, cough, shortness of breath, or other symptoms. Healthcare personnel were assessed at each shift for fever and any symptoms. On March 1st, one member of the staff tested positive for COVID-19 after having worked while mildly symptomatic on February 26th and February 28th. On March 5th, a resident who became symptomatic on March 2nd and was hospitalized was reported as positive for COVID-19. On March 6th, all visitors were restricted and communal activities were discontinued. All staff began to use PPE. CDC initiated an outbreak investigation on March 8th, offering COVID-19 testing to all residents. Next, please. 23 days after identification of the first resident with COVID-19 infection, two-thirds of the residents tested positive for COVID-19, and up to 1 in 4 died. COVID-19 was identified in up to 1 in 5 of the staff, And these numbers are similar to the prior outbreak in another nursing facility in the same county. More than half the residents were pre-symptomatic at the time of testing. Next, please. The study was unable to qualify the contribution of asymptomatic and pre-symptomatic transmission, but large quantities of viral RNA were identified in asymptomatic and pre-symptomatic residents. 26 staff members were diagnosed with symptomatic COVID-19. Healthcare personnel often work when mildly sick, and the potential for viral transmission in pre-symptomatic, mildly symptomatic, and asymptomatic healthcare workers will help to inform future recommendations regarding testing and universal precautions. Next, please. Next. So who said this? To become comfortable with uncertainty is one of the primary goals in the training of a physician. Next. So it's actually number two, Sherwin Newland. Next slide, please. Sherwin Newland was a brilliant surgeon at Yale Medical School. He almost won the Pulitzer Prize for a book, How We Die, Reflections on Life's Final Chapter. And if you really want to hear a great TED talk, he talks about his struggle with severe depression and obsessive compulsive disorder and how he healed himself. Next slide. Sir William Osler is pretty much responsible for how we teach medical students now, and he's got a lot of great quotes. Here's just a short list of some of his many great quotes, and I like the last one. Listen to your patient. He is telling you the diagnosis. Next, please. He was also renowned, not only a renowned author, but historian and practical joker. And he authored The Principles and Practice of Medicine, which was the primary text in which doctors were taught for many years. Next, please. That's one of his great quotes, and it's actually apropos to what's going on with the COVID-19 crisis right now. Next, please. Michael Crichton graduated from Harvard Medical School. He's a best-selling author, producer, director, and screenwriter, but he never practiced medicine, never got a medical license. But he sold over 200 million books, and he's the only creative artist to have simultaneous number one status in U.S. for TV, film, and book sales in the same year. Next, please. So there's a lot of things going on now to help manage the COVID-19 crisis. Repurposed drugs are drugs that are already available that we're going to try to use for COVID-19. Some examples of those are remdesivir, which actually is the only one that has a randomized controlled trial showing some benefit. Other drugs like hydroxychloroquine, Pepcids in trials. So there's a lot of drugs, but the only one that we have any evidence about so far is remdesivir. Antibodies are actually being used currently. So we're actually, at the hospital I go to, we're a community hospital, we're using plasma transfusions. So what people who've already been infected with COVID-19 and they're better, they're completely better, we draw out their blood, just the plasma, and then we use that plasma in patients who are acutely ill with COVID-19. Perhaps more promising, not currently clinically available, but hopefully clinically available in the near future, will be monoclonal antibodies for COVID-19. So there's many companies working on that, more than 16. And what they're trying to do is they identify the most effective antibodies, then they clone them and make a lot of them, and then they use that. And it may be used for both prevention and treatment, the monoclonal antibody research. Now, it's never been tested before. Some companies say they may have something ready by the end of the summer, but it's a very promising approach to it. And it could be a bridge before we get a vaccine. And there are companies, we already use monoclonal antibodies for other conditions like autoimmune diseases and cancer. Most exciting is the vaccine. So there's actually more than 102 companies now working on vaccines. Next slide, please. So the different vaccine technologies that we have, the three of them on the slide, live attenuated vaccines, inactivated vaccines, and subunit vaccines, we've used these with other vaccines. The other three on the other side of the slide, which is messenger RNA and inactivated DNA and using a viral vector, those are new technologies. They've never been used before, but they're very promising. And we hope that out of all these trials that are going on, one of them will come up with an effective vaccine strategy. It always takes time. So they have to go through stage one trials, which are just safety trials, stage two trials, which show how robust the immune response, and then stage three would be how well it actually works in preventing the disease in humans. Two of these vaccines are actually already into a stage two trial because they're between stage one and two, but they've actually started stage two trial. Next, please. So these are some of the vaccines that are in human trials currently. There's actually more than this. Two more have actually gone into stage one to stage two trials. So at this time it's eight, and that's going to increase as time goes on. Next, please. So I used to say 50% of what we learn in residency and medical school is no longer true 10 years later. Next, please. Next. And then I change it to a year, but after the COVID-19 pandemic, I'm changing it to 24 hours because the data is changing so quickly, and it's really a daily looking at the literature, looking at what's available and seeing what's new for our patients. Next, please.
Well, thank you, Dr. Schlam. That was a really helpful talk. And we'll start looking through the feed to see if anyone has any questions about your experience, not just nursing home. I know that's the talk, but you also work at a family medicine residency program for over 30 years. While people are putting in questions into the feed, I want to ask people to reflect how some of their what they've heard today will change their practice, and they can always put that in the feed. And we have a lot of people saying hello. And thank you, and that it was excellent. So you have a lot of fans. I know I thought it was interesting what you talked about, the different options. Can you talk a little bit about what you have done already in the nursing homes and some of your experience?
In our nursing home, I go to three nursing homes. The one where I'm a medical director, as soon as we heard word about the pandemic, we actually allowed no visitors in the facility. And we were very careful about personal hygiene. But what ended up happening, we still had an outbreak there. We had a part-time nurse who worked at another facility, and she worked while she was mildly ill. And then we had several of our nurses and several of our residents get it. Once we knew that she was positive, we cohorted everybody. We didn't have access to testing right away, but we got it over time. And we were very cautious about using personal protective equipment for everyone who had contact with patients. So all group activities were stopped, eating and all the things that we like people to do. So they were really kept to their rooms for the most part, which we hate to do in a nursing home, but we felt that it had to be done because of the infection risk.
Thank you. And then Rick Metterer from Facebook asks, how do you determine criteria for sending a patient into the hospital?
So that's a lot of that has to do with the pulse that Dr. Ahmad went over. So we're very careful about all of our residents having pulse completed. And so we didn't end up sending anybody from the nursing home that I go to the hospital. We're fortunate we have a great nursing staff. We were able to give them oxygen. And unfortunately, we don't have any FDA approved treatments for this. And so the treatment that we do give is oxygen. So it depends on the patient's pulse, what we'll do. I mean, if people get sicker and they wanted to go to the hospital, then of course we would do that. But if we had everybody's wishes well spelled out. Anything that was questionable, we immediately called a family member to clarify that. Thank you for that question. It's important because the advanced care planning, I think, is a critically important part of this whole process in the nursing home, to know ahead of time what people want and to communicate with the family too.
And I think it was impressive that you had it all ready ahead of time for all of them.
Yeah, as part of the Medicare wellness visit that we do, filling out the pulse is part of that. So we do that. That's part of that Medicare wellness visit.
So Prasanna Alada from Facebook asks, can you comment on the antibody testing?
So the antibody testing, there are a bunch of companies out there doing antibody testing. And the key with it is, if you do it in an endemic area, I think the sensitivity and specificity are fine. So if I'm in North Jersey, right near Manhattan, we have a lot of cases. If you go in an area where there's very, very little COVID-19, probably antibody testing, no matter how sensitive and specific is, will lose some of its predictive value. I do think at this time that it's a reasonable thing to do, that, especially in healthcare workers or people who've had a lot of exposure, if people want to know if that's what they had when they had an illness. We do not know at this time if you had the illness and your antibodies are positive, whether you're protected. We don't know that. We hope to find that out in the near future. In other illnesses, that's the case. Not in all viral conditions, but in many it is, but we don't know for COVID-19. Another reason you may want to get the antibody tests are, if you want to donate your plasma and you're positive, you would be a candidate for donating the plasma if you didn't know that you had it before.
And then Ubonix from Facebook asks, are you still taking residents with you to nursing homes?
Yes, the residents come with me to the nursing home. They're very involved. We do not have medical students, actually. So we're not having any medical students in the hospital or nursing home. But the residents have been, our residents at Mountainside Family Practice have been absolutely phenomenal. They have stepped up to the plate and done a great job taking care of patients, and really proud of what they've done over the last month and a half.
And Susan Hill asks, how much from YouTube, how much testing, both PCR and eventual antibody testing, do you think is appropriate in a SNF or nursing home?
They're all great questions. I think more is better than less. So we initially had trouble getting testing because it was difficult in our area for a while to get the testing. Then we started to get more testing, and eventually we tested everybody in the nursing home. I also got the employees tested because an infectious disease doctor in the area was doing a study regarding that. So he tested all the employees. So we had a lot of testing done, but not early on. So my hope would be the more testing, I think, the better. Both with PCR, the nasal swab, and with antibody, because I think you may need both.
And then Arida Del Rio asks, do you think testing is the important thing to keep doing? And I think you kind of answered that question.
Absolutely. I think testing is critical. When the numbers come down, case finding is critical. Public health has really done, you know, a great job. They've really stepped up to the plate too with this, you know, this crisis. It's a different, when the numbers are so high, we really can't do case finding. But once we have the numbers decrease, case finding and testing is the key to keeping it under control. Yeah, I agree.
And then Blaise Vitale asks from Facebook, what is your opinion about mandatory masking, including low-risk counties?
Well, if we don't have enough testing, how do you know what's low-risk? That's the question. So for now, I think that it's important to do the masking. Now, there are different types of masking. So for healthcare providers who are dealing with patients all the time, you really need an N95. I think in public, whether you're outside or you're going to go to a supermarket, I think having a face covering is adequate. But I'll speak for my area. Absolutely, I would agree with face coverings in the area where I am right now. And low risk, I think we have to define what's low risk and how do we know it's low risk? Because unless you have enough testing, it's really hard to know that. So yes, I would continue with face masking, even in low-risk areas, basically, yes.
And then Gil Young Che asks, what is your opinion about transferring a patient from ALF to nursing home in these days?
Yeah, I mean, if people go from an assisted living to the nursing home, a lot of them are combined in the same setting. So if they get sicker, they go to the nursing home facility. If it's a separate facility, I think that nursing home facilities have increased nursing staff. So I think if they need to go, they need to go. Hopefully, if there is COVID-19 in that nursing facility, you have to make sure that it's cohorted, meaning that they won't have exposure to COVID-19 patients. But if there's a medical reason where somebody has to go to from assisted living to nursing facility, higher nursing care, I think you have to do that. Yeah.
And then Bill Ang from Facebook asked, what recommendations do you have to deal with social emotional isolation of the nursing home residents and at the same time protecting them from asymptomatic spread of COVID-19?
That's all very good questions. So technology is helpful with this. So they can FaceTime, they can do group things on Zoom. The nursing homes can take advantage of it, some advanced technology. And I know the nurses in our facility have been very, great with that. Some of the patients can't do it on their own, so they'll assist them with those things. So either FaceTiming their family or doing a Zoom meeting with a group or doing group activities on the television where they'll have like exercises or some lectures or movies so they can, a virtual, so to speak, community. But unfortunately, it's not optimal, but during this COVID pandemic, I don't think we have too much of an option. The second part of the question was, can we do asymptomatic spread? Asymptomatic spread, we need to do more testing. That's the key, and that's why I presented that in New England Journal of Medicine article. I think we have to be very aggressive testing. I think that's the key. You're making a good point. Because the pre-symptomatic, asymptomatic is when things get out of hand before we know about it. So we need to be aggressive testing. And once we get enough tests, we got to test asymptomatic people more, especially in high-risk communities like a nursing home.
And Doc Bain 1 actually asks, could you discuss your criteria for testing PCR or NAT?
Well, the more the better. So, of course, when people have clinical symptoms of it, but it depends on how much testing is available and how much COVID-19 is in your area. But for me, the more testing you do, the better. Because we know that pre-symptomatic, asymptomatic spread is something that's probably, we're pretty sure, you never can be 100%, but we're pretty sure that that's something that's making this pandemic worse. So the more people we can check, even if they're asymptomatic, the better off you are, especially if they're going into a high-risk population like a nursing home or a hospital. So more is better, but we need to have adequate testing ability. Right? So how many tests do we have and how much can we do it?
And then Manveen Sekhon asks, admissions to prisons, what testing criteria to use?
Yeah, so that's another high-risk community. So for me, they should be tested, right? The best test to probably, you could do the PCR, but if you do a combination of PCR and the antibody, if enough testing becomes available, the two together are better than either alone. As you know, PCR is for acute infection. Antibody will tell you if they were previously infected.
And then Vicky Roberts asks, why do some states like my state, Missouri, not reporting nursing home cases to the public?
Nursing homes, they run businesses and they, having a COVID-19 outbreak is probably not something that's a popular thing, but they have to report it now. So it's actually CMS regulation that if they have any COVID-19 patient now, they have to report it to the CDC immediately. So that we're going to get more accurate statistics. But and also they want to be, it can panic people. I mean, if they only have one case, right? So I think in the beginning that may have been, I can't speak for nursing homes because I don't know their thought process with it. But now it's mandatory. They have to report it. But I think they were also worried about, they don't want to panic people and make people really worried and try to pull people out of the nursing home when they were safe. I can't tell you exactly what happened with the nursing homes as far as reporting, but now they have to do it.
And then Mike Cochran asks, I get a patient to the nursing home out of a hospital, COVID test negative in the hospital. Should we get another test upon admission to the nursing home?
It depends on your likelihood of, of suspicion. So one COVID-19 test is just one COVID-19 test. The sensitivity of that test, it's anywhere from 60 to 70. The numbers go from 50 to 75%. So I had a family doctor who had two negative COVID-19 tests, and then the third one was positive. And I've had many patients who've had negative COVID-19 tests and another one's positive. So if you have a patient with a negative test, but you're highly suspicious, then you should test them again. If you're not if they had a negative test, but you're not suspicious that they have COVID-19, that's a judgment call.
And then Kareem Marlowe asks, are nursing homes and SNFs being reimbursed additionally compensation by the insurance companies for individual COVID-19 cases?
I don't know the answer to that as far as reimbursement. Not that I know of, but I'm not sure about that. That's an interesting question. I don't really know.
And then Will Sawyer from Facebook asks, my experience is face shields are effective for healthy patients and compliance is better than masking. Any thoughts on that for the public and in an office setting?
I don't know of a study showing the face shields are better or worse than masks. There may be, I don't know that. But I think they're both options. I think in the hospital, what I do is I wear goggles, an N95 mask, and a face shield. I'm particularly cautious. But in public, I know that the CDC has been recommending masking. I don't know their recommendation about face shields or the data on that, actually. It's an interesting question.
And then Kim Yu made a comment of, but the antibody test is not specific to COVID-19. Most tests for multiple strains of coronaviruses.
That's a good point. So some of the tests are more sensitive and specific than others. There's 8 down and out FDA approved, and some of them are very sensitive and specific. So the sensitivity and positive predictive value and negative predictive value is actually very good in a highly endemic area like where I am in North Jersey, Manhattan, or New Orleans. If you go to an area where you have a low prevalence of COVID-19, then even the ones that are higher, you know, sensitivity, they won't have as good a positive or negative predictive value. So the point is the antibody tests are best used in areas where there's more COVID-19. How much? Probably at least 5% of the population infected. You know, I don't know that that's a magic number, but certainly in our area, it meets that criteria to do the antibody testing. In other areas of the country, maybe not.
Thank you. And thank you for making that point. I also want to remind people to, as part of the T2P, to put in any information that they learned today and how it's going to change their practice. And we'll go to the next question. Kim Yu, what PPE are nursing home staff wearing and how do you decrease spread at nursing homes?
So the PPE in the nursing home is similar to in the hospital. They'll wear a gown, disposable gown. They'll wear gloves. They'll wear an N95 mask and they'll wear a face shield. If they don't want to wear a face shield, they wear goggles. In the very beginning of this, we had a little trouble getting enough PPE because we were kind of caught off guard. So a very strong recommendation would be make sure you have PPE. If you're working in a nursing home, if you're a medical director, if you have contact with anybody who has a part in a nursing home, make sure you have enough PPE. Fortunately, the nursing homes that I go to, all of them, they're very, you know, they want to protect their employees and do the right thing, sure, almost all nursing homes do. And so they were very aggressive in getting everything that we needed in a timely fashion. But sometimes it's just hard to get it because there's a very low supply. Hopefully that won't be the case in the future.
And Doc Bain 1 asked, what should we tell families who want to take the elder out of the nursing home? Should we test prior to allowing this, i.e. going from high risk nursing home to low risk family home?
Yeah, so I mean, that may be a choice by some families if they want to do that. And it is an option for people. If there's been no COVID-19 in the nursing home, they want to take them out because they're afraid that it'll come there. I mean, that's a decision they have to make as a family. I think our job, anybody who's involved in nursing, is trying to do the preventive measures as strictly as possible before to try to prevent it. But that's an option for people if they feel that's best.
And then Manveen Sikhan says, reuse of N95, what's your recommendation on storing masks and reusing every 4 days or so? Thanks.
Yeah, there's a lot of different things that people are doing for the mask, putting them in paper bags, and there's some cleaning things. Optimally, what we'll I think the optimal thing with N95 is to use one for the day and then toss it at the end of the day, but that may not be practical in a lot of institutions where you have a shortage. But if you look on the internet, there's a host of different ways that you can make the N95 mask last longer. There's a lot of them on there. But you got to be careful. As you can see, if you look closely at my nose, you can get a lot of sores and redness on your nose and your face from the N95 mask. So now I've been putting some cream on before I put the mask on. I hope. But another thing is, we're probably going to get so many companies making N95 that we'll have a readily available amount of N95s in the future.
And Kim, you asked, are you using more telehealth in nursing homes?
So when I was in the hospital and I had trouble getting over to the nursing home, I did use telehealth there. I called. But then when I was having to do hospital rounds and I couldn't be used telehealth that week, because I usually go to that nursing home once a week. But then once we not, I would dress in my PPE and go there. We dressed in the same personal protective equipment in the nursing home that we use at the hospital. And I think it was good to see the patients. They really appreciated us being there, even though we were dressed kind of funny and they commented on that. But you could do it either way. Telehealth is also a very reasonable and good way to handle the nursing home also. You could do it either way.
And then Mike Cochran actually makes a comment in reference to Doc Bain regarding diagnosing in the short term and suggests testing. You might want to test to prove that the person in the nursing home is negative now. So if diagnosed in the short term, have evidence that they didn't get it from the facility. And that was just a comment.
Yeah. Yeah. That's a good comment. Yeah. That's what I like about these. You get a lot of good ideas from people when you get a bunch of family docs together.
Well, thank you. It seems like testing has been mentioned as a really important aspect. I do want to remind people for reflection time to please share your key takeaways from today's session in the comments section so that we can see what other people might want to do in their practices. I know some people are already mentioning a lot of testing, and Doc Bain also mentioned about testing before leaving the nursing home. If there's any other thoughts that people have of what they might be doing in their practice based on what they heard today, it would be helpful for other viewers to hear. So I'll give a moment for people to reflect. And Robert Smith asks, are there any studies about the effects of social isolation on overall health of nursing home residents as a result of not being allowed visitors or personal contact with relatives?
I don't know of a study, but I think it'd be an excellent one to do. Because, of course, you know, being with people is such an important thing for people in nursing homes and assisted living facilities. Unfortunately, that's a significantly, I think, severe side effect of this pandemic. So it's a really good point. It's a good study to do.
Thank you. And so what I saw mostly in the feed was information about people thinking that testing is important and some issues regarding PPE. We'll give people a few more minutes to see if they have any other reflections. Eubonics from Facebook says, we'll continue to do our best caring for patients, learn more each day together, and continue to train our residents to be a bright future for family medicine. And I think it was helpful to hear. I don't know if everybody heard all the activities that the residents at your residency program were doing and how they stepped up to the plate.
Yeah, I can reiterate. Our residents were really wonderful. They worked extra hard. Never, you know, any doubt in their minds that they did what they had to do and no question about, you know, what they had to do, and they were very caring, compassionate. I can't say enough about really how they responded. Very proud of them. No, and also the people in the hospital, the nurses and at the nursing home and in the hospital, truly amazing the work that they've done throughout this pandemic.
I know when we were talking earlier, you had said that you'd never seen anything like this before in your 34 years.
No,
of practicing.
But I've never seen anything like this virus, and I've never seen anything like the healthcare team coming together and working together and doing the best job they could under difficult circumstances either. And I'm particularly excited about the vaccines that are coming out. We've never, ever had a race for a vaccine, anything like this. And these newer technologies are amazing, even though they've never been tested before. And I'm very hopeful that one among all these candidates is going to really help us, because I think a vaccine is critical in combating this virus.
And then Veena Desai says, we'll do more discussion with patients on end-of-life pulsed wishes earlier on.
Well, Veena was a great resident of ours at Mountainside, so thank you, Veena. She was a phenomenal resident, yeah.
And then Tim Martindale says, hello from Waco, Texas, from a family physician who just recovered from COVID and back in the clinic.
Wow. Well, I'm glad you're feeling better, Tim. And it's remarkable how doctors like yourself, you recover and you go right back doing the work you love. So I think that's amazing. And thanks for the work you do.
And thank you. And I'm glad you recovered.
Yeah. Kim, thank goodness you're better.
Yeah. Kim Yu asks, any updates on the National Pulse form?
Not that I know of. I don't know that there's any updates on the National Pulse form. There's other forms that you can do also. I use the Pulse, but there's a bunch of different forms that you can use for end-of-life decisions.
Well, everybody's very excited waiting for the vaccine, and I think we have a lot of love, especially for Tim and you in the feed.
Tim, thank God you're better.
Well, thank you, everyone, for joining us for this session and for reflection time and all the questions you had. If you have any other additional questions, you can always post them, and Dr. Schlam will do his best to answer them and post them to the message board. And please join us for our next session, Managing COVID-19 with Limited Resources, a Rural Family Physician's Experience, with guest speaker, Dr. Naomi Clancy. Thank you.